So that beautiful angelic music began the process of carrying us deep, deep down into that space where there is nothing but wholeness, nothing but beauty, nothing but joy, and where we know without doubt, with all of our faith, that truly all is well. Let us use our power of imagination for a moment. And let's imagine that we are time travelers and that we are choosing to move back over 2,000 years ago. To the Middle East, to Palestine, to Israel, to Judea, a place that is barren, desert, hot. And at that time, as you are living in your small village, many itinerant ministers travel through your area. Many people speaking the word of God as they understand it. And you are filled with hope. You are filled that whatever condition you are living with, that someone, one of these rabbis, might be able to heal you. Time and time you see people healed. Time and time you see people coming forth with their needs and no healing takes place. And you may have doubts. But one day, one of these itinerant ministers comes with his entourage to your village. And people flock to him. And your hope rises. And you go to where this rabbi is teaching. And you hear his words. You hear his words that ignite a greater hope in you than you have ever had. And you begin to recognize that that is faith. And you state your need. And a voice within you says, you are whole. You are well. All is well. The kingdom of God lives within you, where all beauty resides. Take a moment and rest with that, knowing that all is well, that regardless of what our senses see, we can trust, have the faith that all is always well, just as the rabbi told you that day. And then very gently, come forth more than 2,000 years into today. See the world as it is through your eyes. Experience through your physical senses. And pay attention to how difficult it is sometimes to remember the words that you were given. All is well. Perhaps you're facing a health challenge and you go to your physician with great hope. And in your hope, sometimes you leave that appointment with a true knowing that all is well. And sometimes you leave with doubt. And then that still voice within you says, never fear, never fear. You are on your spiritual path, on a beautiful journey that always holds you with love and light on every step that you take. And you remember that regardless of what's happening in your life, you always have the ability to turn within, to go to that very quiet place that was ignited in a lifetime, many lifetimes ago, where you knew without doubt. And so as Reverend Rich said in his prayer, all we need is faith the size of a little mustard seed. That tiny black seed that we can barely see. When we have just that much faith, we know that we are held in the arms of love. We know that whatever challenges we are facing, that all is well, because we are on our soul's journey. And we were created in the image and likeness of God. Whole, perfect, complete. So take a moment and rest. Rest with the knowingness that you are all that you need to be, that you are perfect just as you are, and that regardless of how you're feeling in any given moment, you have the power, the ability to move to that space once again, where you trust, where you have faith, where you perceive the truth and you live with peace. You live with love. You live with a joy that you cannot even imagine, because all is well. When you're ready, take a deep breath. Sigh it out. Wiggle your fingers and toes, maybe roll your shoulders. Recognizing that all that you felt in your visualization is possible for you in each moment. And when you're ready, return to this here and now as we prepare for another beautiful song. And so it is.
This is a Brandi Carlile song, and I think it dovetails nicely with that meditation.
And we know there's a lot of stormy weather out there, and this song is about staying in the eye of the storm.
Wrapped your love around me like a Aletheia rising. Thank you. Thank you so much. Gosh, thank you. I am a sturdy soul. There ain't no shame in laying down in the bed you made. I just love that. Thank you. There ain't no shame in laying down in the bed you made, everybody. Remember that. Take that with you today. We're sturdy souls. And speaking of sturdy souls, I am just so excited that Carolyn is with us today. I've been waiting for this for 6-7 months now. We've been working on the date to come together. And I'll tell you why in a minute, but I want to thank everybody for their flexibility and moving through the changes in the service this morning. Thank you, Audrey, for being the prayer chaplain today. Thank you, Anne, for the announcements. Aletheia Rising for being here. For Mary Lindsay for punting at the last minute and getting us set up with the song. Not everybody can do that. Thank you, Mary Lindsay. Appreciate it. Appreciate everybody. And thank you. You know, about 7 years ago, I walked into the big community room at Unity of Vacaville. It was a regional meeting, and our previous minister at Unity Center of David, Reverend Catherine Brenson, was there. And as soon as I walked into the room, there was this attraction. There was just pure love peering out from where Catherine was standing. You could feel it. You could sense it. It just came over you and you wanted it. And the closer I got to Catherine, the more love I felt. What a love Catherine still is. And when I walk into a room when Carolyn Warnemuende's there, I feel the same way. I feel love just coming forth. She's a keeper of love. She's a giver of love. She's a receiver of love. And I like being in her presence. So I invite you to welcome to Unity Center of Davis for the first time this morning, Reverend Carolyn Warnemuende. Thank you for being here, Carolyn. Good morning.
Oh, thank you, Rich. Thank you so much. And one thing I do know about me, I love people and I love to share that love. So this morning, even though we are afar from each other, we are together. I have to tell you, I have never done a virtual church before. During the pandemic, what I would do is I would go into my church and I would record the services and then they would be shown. And of course, we did live streaming when I was still the minister there. But to do something completely virtually is a new experience. And I was talking to Reverend Rich, I don't know, 2 or 3 days ago. And I was feeling apprehensive, like, oh my gosh, how am I going to do this? But never fear. Don't worry. He didn't use the words have faith, but that's what he was saying. Is Carolyn, have faith. All is well. It's good. And the minute I came on this morning, I think there were 4 of you on. And I looked in your eyes and I saw your smile. I said, yep, all is well. I can do this. So let's just be together this morning in this heart space that we all share as we talk about, let's look at moving mountains using our power of faith. I love the 12 powers. The 12 powers is my favorite part of Unity. And doesn't matter what I'm doing, I can draw on one of those powers. And it's really no accident that several months ago when Reverend Rich and I planned today that I said, okay, yes, I'm going to talk on faith. Let's call it, let's look at moving mountains. And I'm at a time in my life right now where sometimes I'm challenged with my faith. And so it's wonderful to be able to be a minister and to be in a situation where I am always reminding myself of what I know. And so this morning, I'll share with you some of the things that I think are important about faith. A number of years ago, there was a movie on Netflix, and I think it was called The Ben Carson Story. And it was the story of the renowned world surgeon, Ben Carson, who later got involved in politics. But as a neurosurgeon, he was well respected, well loved. He was excellent at what he did. When Ben was a child, though, that was not his story. he was thought to be a slow learner. He had difficulty with math. He had difficulty with reading. He called himself stupid and dumb. And his mother never believed that about him. She would support him and she would say, "Ben, all is well. Just use the mind that you've been given." And he received tutoring and he got glasses. And one day, in a very poignant part of the story, Ben was having a particularly difficult time. And his mom said, "Ben, you just gotta see what you can't see." And isn't that what faith is? We gotta see what we can't see. We have to be willing to trust that it is there for us. To become who he became, Ben needed guides, just like we do. When we're all on the spiritual path together, we turn to each other and we support each other and we guide each other. That's our job as spiritual beings, having this beautiful human experience. So this morning, take a minute, just sort of close your eyes if you choose. And what would you say that your spiritual quotient is? On a scale from 1 to 10, with low being 1 being low and 10 being high. And I didn't mean spiritual quotient, I meant faith quotient. So what is your faith quotient this morning? And is it blind faith? Is it what powerful New Thought writer Emily Cady called blind faith, which is an intrinsic trust in a higher power, but also always a doubt? Will this higher power, will this God, this whatever you call this power, really answer prayer? Or is it what Emily called understanding faith? A faith that is built on immutable spiritual law, on law that always works, a law that we can trust with our whole being. Each of us has chosen to join together this morning because we have faith in a higher power, or we're searching for one. And we are together on this path to guide and to assist each other. In Paul's letter to the Hebrews, he wrote about faith, or he spoke about faith. This is found in Hebrews 11, verse 1. Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for the conviction of things not seen. We've heard this verse a lot, haven't we? The assurance of things not seen. You gotta see what you can't see. Indeed, by faith, our ancestors received approval. By faith, we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was made from many things that are not visible. After Paul wrote these words to the Hebrews, he went on and he talked to them about faith heroes from the Hebrew scriptures, the Old Testament. These were a few people that were feeling isolated and ostracized. And just like you and I, sometimes we need faith heroes to remind us that all is well. And Paul wrote to his people about Noah. Noah, who in the myth, in the story, was purported to be 500 years old when he was called to build the ark. He reminded them of the story of Abraham, who had so much faith in God that he was willing to take his son up the mountain to be sacrificed. And then, of course, that didn't have to happen. And he was they were reminded of the story of Moses, who at 80 years of age was commanded by God to carry the people from Israel to the promised land, to release them from Babylon and carry them to the promised land. Heroes that those people could draw on in those ancient times. Heroes that if we choose, we can remember. Because of their faith, they could move mountains. They could overcome huge obstacles to do what they were called to do. And we are called to do many things today that we may think, I could not possibly do that. And yet we can. Each one of us was born with the power of faith to the fullest. We have always had all the faith within us that we have ever needed. But it's where we place our faith. Jesus was a master psychologist. He knew people well. And he knew that on our human path, we have doubts. And this is what he told the people. And you know this verse too. Matthew 17:20. This is what he taught. For truly I tell you, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will be moved, and nothing will be impossible for you. Where Jesus taught was an agrarian society, so people understood his stories about the earth. They knew mustard. They knew that the mustard seed could be almost invisible to the human eye. But there it was. He was saying, you don't need to have huge, huge faith. All you need is faith the size of a mustard seed. And you can say to this mountain, move from here to there. Now, metaphysically, we know that what Jesus was saying, that you, through your power of faith, have the opportunity to move any obstacle in your life. You can say to whatever your challenge is, health challenges, financial challenges, whatever they may be, say, you move from here to there. Through my faith, I can feel it happening. And it is through the feeling, it is not only the words we use, but the feeling that we bring to them. So we don't say, you could move from here to there. No, we proclaim, move from here to here. It is within our power. In her little book, Lessons in Truth, Emily Cady talks to us about faith, and she describes the power that we each have. Listen to what Emily says. The mental and spiritual world or realms are governed by laws that are just as real as unfailing as the laws that govern the natural world. You and I trust gravity. We know that if we drop something, it's going to fall because gravity always works. And Emily says that the spiritual laws are just as real and as unfailing as these laws that govern the natural world. Certain conditions of mind are so connected with certain results that the two are inseparable. If we have the one, we must have the other, as surely as night follows day. Not because we believe some wise person's testimony that such is the case. Not even because the voice of intuition tells us that it is so. But because the whole matter is based on laws that can neither fail nor be broken. Think of that. Imagine that. Our faith is a law that cannot be broken. When we use our faith, whatever it is that we have faith in is bound to transpire. But we have two jobs. We have two jobs in practicing our faith. The first is that we need to raise our awareness, raise our consciousness. And we do this not only through prayer and meditation. You're going to hear the chimes of my friend's clock behind you. But also by watching the physical world. We know that the sun rises each morning, whether we can see it or not. We know that fall follows winter. It is inevitable. We never have to worry or think about it. So we watch the physical world. We watch what happens in our lives and in the lives of others. And we raise our consciousness by watching the good that is always at work. The second thing that we have to do in practicing our faith is we need to make a demand on that great unmanifest. I like to call it the great soup. And I can close my eyes and I can imagine that every idea, every thought that has ever been or ever will be is in that great soup. And all we need to do is reach up and grab what attracts us. And through our faith, set the intention. And focus and hold that attention, asking for this or something better. Now, sometimes we think, isn't that odd that we have to make a demand? Doesn't God know what we want even before we ask? That was the message we'd been given. I had a congregant in my church in Reading, and he had come from a more traditional background. And he said, God is the perfect gentleman. God never intervenes in our life unless we ask. And we do need to ask. In the Synoptic Gospels and in John, we are told again and again, ask and ye shall receive. Ask and it shall be given to you. Jesus wasn't asking us to beg. He wasn't asking us to plead. He was asking as an intention. He was asking as an affirmation. Have you ever thought that your affirmations are a way of asking and a way of receiving? Consider that the next time you choose to do an affirmation. Faith is a tricky power. We can use our faith positively, or we can get into a downward spiral and we can use our faith negatively. Have you ever had physical pain, or have you ever had a situation in your life that seemed dire? And it didn't matter how hard you tried, your mind kept drifting back to those what ifs. Oh my gosh, what if this pain never goes away? Or oh my gosh, what if my grandchild who's learning to drive is in an accident? As human beings, we do that, but we have the power to change our minds, to turn around those negative thoughts so that we're using them in a positive way. Many of you know the authors, Mary Alice and Richard Jaffala. They wrote The Quest and Adventures on the Quest, and they wrote a book that I came across recently called The Lazarus Blueprint. And it is using the story of Lazarus as a blueprint for our own life. And they have six steps to follow. I'm finding it a very powerful book. And in speaking of expectations and intentions and our power of faith, this is what the Jaffalas tell us. Expectations gather a tremendous vortex of power around them. An energy that draws to you people and circumstances and bodily changes that will support those expectations. Knowing this, you can see how critical it is to create strong, positive expectations. Unfortunately, without expectations that are strong and positive, it's easy to default to the thoughts and attitudes of most of the population. The gloom of cable news channels, the caustic babble of talk shows, the screaming headlines of newspaper, the buzz at the water cooler. These all fall into the category of negative faith placed outward. So we have a big job, don't we? We want to surround ourselves with people who are positive, that know that all is well. I don't know about you, but I've had situations in my life that I've been in, and I can't imagine how there could be any good in the situation at all. And yet, in retrospect, I look back at every single thing that's happened in my life, and I can see the goodness in it because each of those opportunities brought me to where I am today. Just like all that has happened in your life before has brought you to where you are today. And you had the faith to keep following the path. We don't follow the path unless we have that knowingness within us saying, yes, you can do this. We use our power of strength, one of the other 12 powers, and we persevere along the way. So on this journey of faith, we raise our consciousness and we make our demand, we set our intention, but we have three other things that we also need to do. We need to show up. Years and years ago, when my nephew went off to college, he was saying to my husband once, "Uncle, I know the secret of college. It's showing up." And isn't that the secret on our spiritual path? We show up. We gather people around us who are positive. We show up on Sundays to our beautiful church. We show up to receive the support and the encouragement of those that we trust and that we love. And we show up to our own set of boundaries, keeping those at a distance who fall into using their power of faith in a negative way. As well as showing up, we keep at it. We persevere. Even through our dark nights of the soul, we use our affirmations. We use that power of faith. And you know as well as I do that we always come out on the other side. Maybe not like we thought we would, but when we set our intentions with this or something better, the universe always complies. Always brings us just what we need if we choose to see it, to take us on our journey. The final step that we want to do is we want to offer gratitude before we see what we can't see. Do you remember before Jesus' healings how he always thanked his Father first? Before he raised Lazarus from the tomb, if that's how you choose to read that story. He looked up. He didn't look into the tomb. He looked up and he said, "Father, you have always heard me and you hear me now. Thank you." So we say thank you. We say thank you for what we have not yet seen because it keeps us in our power of faith, knowing that we gotta see what we can't yet see. And with gratitude, we can truly believe that. So I would like to invite you to join me this week as each of us in our own way choose to use our faith, knowing that each of us who is here this morning is supporting each other. Knowing that we are choosing those to keep around us who can support us in the faith of holding our intentions, in the faith of knowing all is well, when sometimes our physical senses show us absolutely the opposite. But as well as those physical senses which shows the opposite, they are also those senses that show us the beauty of the world in which we live. And if we choose to place our faith in that beauty, we can rest with assurance that truly all is well. And I will hold that this week for each of you, just as I hold it for myself. Thank you.